Our next guest spent 10 years sitting alongside Mary Hart, hosting the iconic Entertainment Tonight, and he recently reunited with her at the ET anchor desk. Take a look.
Hello, everyone. I'm John Tesh.
And I'm Mary Hart, and I get to say welcome, John Tesh, to the show.
John and I anchored at the ET desk together for 10 years. One favorite memory? His audition from back in 1986.
TV viewers will have the chance to vote for their favorite song next week.
How did that feel?
I felt pretty good. I mean, with your coaching, it felt even better.
Oh, well.
I was in a flop sweat. I was really nervous. I really wanted the job. You were very sweet, and it was very different for me. So I sweated through a couple of shirts.
Oh, please welcome back celebrated TV personality, concert pianist, and author, the amazing John Tesh.
Great to be with you guys. Thank you.
Oh my gosh, how do you feel watching those videos, John?
A long time ago. It was a long time ago, yeah, and the audition, it was a lot worse than what you saw, because I just come from CBS Sports, so I was still doing downhill skiing, right? And so when I first did that, what you didn't see, because they didn't keep the tape, was that when they had me read the celebrity birthdays, and I was like, I don't want to blow out the audio guy, but it was, you know, celebrating a birthday today, like, you know, there he is, Bill Johnson, he's hit the gate, he's off the course, he's on the course, and Mary's like, stop, you know? So we had to start all over again.
Oh, my gosh, but you look exactly the same,
Sure, thanks.
Way.
Let's go with that. You did a great job.
That, you know, that first interview was pretty amazing for that to be your first interview, if that's what we were seeing. Now, listen, your new book, Relentless, chronicles 45 years of your amazing career, and which in turn has made you one of the most liked men in show business. I mean, I think
it is safe to say
there's not one person who has ever met John Tesh or seen him on TV that goes, I don't like that guy. You're very likable, John. Which is why I was really surprised to hear that you were nearly fired from Entertainment Tonight at the beginning because people thought you were snarky towards Mary.
I was trying to be cool because I had come from news and come from sports. And so when I was doing and that's what they wanted a newsier approach to the show, right? So when I'm on there and Mary would say things like, you know, wow, it looks like they're friends off screen as well. Something really nice. And I go, yeah, whatever. You know, and I did a lot of stuff with my tongue in cheek, you know. And so they called me in and they said, hey, listen, we want you to go to body language school. And I said, what?
There's a thing?
And they said, they said that you're being, our focus group say you're being mean to Mary. And I said, I love Mary. We're good friends. Well, it doesn't show. So you have to go. And I said, I'm not going. They said, well, then we're going to fire you. So I went to Dallas for 4 days. This is like, I don't know, maybe 6 months after I was in the job. And there was a lady there, and the coach, and she had a tape, VHS tape, of like, I don't know, 50 different times all strung together when I was like, yeah, whatever, you know, trying to stay. And so I realized it. I said, oh, my gosh, I'm being a jerk. So she trained it out of me. she had scripts from the last 5 months. So she became Mary, and I was me, and she taught me how to be a nice person.
Oh,
the funny thing is that Mary never even knew any of this.
No, television amplifies things, and sometimes hand gestures like this look like they're huge.
You'd make a great therapist, thank you.
Oh, thank you. Well, I am on this. That's my side hustle.
You're trying to impress her. You're trying to be like cool, you know.
I was trying to do the show. I was a jerk.
Nobody believed that.
Jerk,
well, the title of your book, Relentless, applies to so many aspects of your life, but especially, I have to say, your pursuit of one particular female celebrity who ended up being your wife.
We're coming up on 28 years, Connie Selica, and I was on Entertainment Tonight. She was shooting a show called P.S. I Love You with Greg Evigan in Palm Springs, right? And so I'm a big fan of Connie's from Greatest American Hero. And I walk into the gym just to sort of get a quick workout before I'm going to do my job. And there is Connie Selica, and she was just voted one of the top five most beautiful women in the world. And she's on a bicycle, and she's wearing what you guys wear at the gym. Like, I don't know what it's called, like a leotard and this thing.
Workout clothes.
But it was like, you know.
Oh, the 80s.
Yeah.
So picture Olivia Newton-John.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Musical. Yeah, there you go. Thank you very much. I wish I'd used that. Yeah, so anyway, so she's on the bike. She's pedaling away. She's looking at the digital display. I see her. I'm like, oh, my gosh. So I'm not talking to this woman, you know. So I jump up onto the high bar, not realizing that I haven't done a chin-up since I was in junior high school. So I'm trying to pull myself off 225 pounds off the ground. So I started swinging like this, like, you know, I'm just stretching, you know.
Wow.
Then I got on the sit-up bench, and there were these stirrups up there, right? And it was like this. I put my feet in there, and I leaned down, and I couldn't sit back up. So I'm a failed person, right? So I tried to leave the gym just immediately before I embarrassed myself any further. All of a sudden, I hear this voice go, John Tesh? And I whip around and go, oh, Connie Selica, I didn't see you there,
right? Sure.
Yeah. And so that's how we met. And then she said, well, you know, maybe we can get together sometime. And I said, well, how, you know, how about Friday? I'm going to be back Friday. And she said, yeah, that'd be great, you know. And I ran up to my hotel room and I sent her a CD of my music saying maybe you should listen to music that was written for a bike race since you're riding a bike, and I'll see you on Friday. And I chickened out. And then when Friday came in, I didn't show up.
You stood her up?
I stood her up.
She got ready to go out with you, and you just didn't go?
I chickened out, and then I went on. And then finally I realized what a jerk I was and went to the ET research department, got all the research on her, memorized everything. And then I carpet bombed her phone. And I mean, it's in the book, right? There's a lot of details. There's two chapters on this. I had a fireworks display. I rented out a restaurant, wrote a song for her, had a little small orchestra play for it. I finally got a date with her, right? And 4 months after that, we were engaged. And 6 months after that, we were married. So, I mean, I think I knew when I first saw her on Greatest American Hero that this was the... I just panicked, you know?
How long before it was where she actually agreed to go out with you again? After
it was months and months and months.
Okay.
And
listen, it worked out. All these years later, 28 years, that is...
28 years, three grandkids, and we were not ever going to speak of it again, so thanks for bringing it up.
Well, you know, in the book, you say that God led you to Connie.
Right.
And Connie led you back to God.
Right.
And you both really credit your deep faith in God for helping you overcome your fatal cancer diagnosis. Tell us about this.
Yeah, in 2015, I was diagnosed with a rare form of cancer. It didn't make any blood markers, but it was, they basically said, you know, get your affairs in order. And get your affairs in order ended up, you know, with a sonogram and then a biopsy and then two surgeries at Johns Hopkins and MD Anderson. And if it weren't for Connie, we wouldn't be here talking because she was my advocate. And and along the way, I mean, I had faith for the doctors, but along the way, we were renewing our faith in particular scriptures, healing scriptures in the Bible that I had never discovered before. And I grew up in the church, and one of them was Mark 11:23, which is tattooed on my arm, and the rest of my family has it. And it's basically about speaking your future, speaking faith-filled words over yourself, right? Mark 11:23 is, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will be done, will have whatever he says. Therefore, whatever you ask when you pray, believe that you receive it. And so we were manifesting my healing because it just kept coming back. The cancer was relentless, and even the doctors couldn't stop it. And here I am.
Wow. How are you today?
Yeah. I'm alive, I'm well, I'm blessed, and I'm cancer-free.
Oh. Amazing. What a beautiful scripture. Oh.
Absolutely. Well, and part of this book is really a love story because there's a lot of the cancer story. It's not all about cancer, but the cancer story is titrated throughout my life story, you know, which began with me being homeless in a tent, being kicked out of college for forging a professor's signature. But the rest of the story is in the book, so I'm sure we don't have time for that whole thing.
John Tesh, you're amazing. An amazing man. And again, I'm going to say it, you're still the most liked man in show.
You're very, very
kind.
Yes,
you are. You and George Clooney, my friend.
Oh, boy.
You're in good company.
Yeah.
For more information on everything John Tesh, including his weekly radio show, which you should absolutely listen to, and his new memoir, you can visit Tesh.com.